Okay, so thank you very much for the presentation, and I would like to thank the organization for having me to here today. This was not as organized. Professor Casas was supposed to be here today, but he wasn't available, and he's very sorry for not coming here today. I hope that I will be up for this task. I've been learning from him for several years, and here we are in the SPEA conference that Sisto and José Antonio prepared last year, and I hope that I will be up of the expectation that he may have caused in you. So the first thing is to contextualize, why are we working on catalytic oxidation? The majority of us are working to degrade organic pollutants. So the organic matter, in order to become oxidized towards CO2 and water, needs a very high amount of energy, thus the Caimada. If you remember what we studied in high school or in the first years of your bachelor degree, we need to overcome a certain level of energy to go from the reagents to our products. But if we add a catalyst, we can modify this energy this activation energy so that we can work in milder conditions. This talk will be focused on the oxidation of organic matter through the catalytic activation of oxygen to give rise to superoxide radicals in the catalytic wet air oxidation process, and the activation of hydrogen peroxide giving rise to hydroxyl radicals in the catalytic wet peroxide oxidation. First of all, I would like to explain the difference between the wet air oxidation and the catalytic one. Wet air oxidation was developed in the 1930s by the Simpro company, and it works at very high temperatures because we need to have a high temperature in order to activate the oxygen and have a reasonable oxidation rate, and also at very high pressures in order to obtain our dissolved oxygen in the reaction media. This is translated into a very expensive process, not only in terms of the operating conditions, but also because of the installation. We will need reaction vessels that are able to endure these very harsh conditions. 20 years after, 1950s, DuPont developed the first manganese chromium zinc oxides for the catalytic wet air oxidation. With this process, we can work 100 degrees Celsius below the temperature of the wet air oxidation, and with also a very significantly lower pressure, because, as we saw before, the addition of a catalyst will make our activation energy lower. This is translated as money, and we engineers love making things more economically feasible. So about the reaction mechanism, in order to activate the oxygen and generate the superoxide radical, which in acidic media will become a hydroxyl radical, we need an electron, and this is going to be given by our catalyst, which will be oxidized. We are talking about a catalyst, so we need to regenerate it, and we need to take an electron from another place. In the case of the catalytic wet air oxidation, the reaction intermediates, the radical ones, can give this electron to the catalyst, regenerating it. This is not as simple as it may seem here. Various authors have described the coupling reactions in which the radical are intermediates can react between them, generating some polymers like biphenyls. These polymers will be deposited into the catalyst, and so we are going to have a dual effect. On one side, we are going to have the catalyst deactivation by fouling. We are going to cover our active sites. But these polymers will also give the electrons that we need to regenerate our catalyst. Okay, so our polymers are bad and good at the same time. Regarding the catalysts that are commonly used in the catalytic wet air oxidation process, for the metal ones, we have the homogeneous process, which are based on the use of copper salts, which have a very high activity, but we need a second step in order to retrieve them. On the second hand, we have the heterogeneous catalytic wet air oxidation, which at the industrial scale works with platinum, palladium, or ruthenium supported onto zirconium or titanium oxides. And at a research level, we have transition metals oxides, which have a very high activity, but a low stability due to the metal leaching, which will cause an additional pollution, or supported noble metals. These have a very high activity and stability, but they are very expensive. Another alternative is the use of carbon materials. If we take a close look onto the surface of the activated carbons, We will see that we have different superficial oxygenated groups. Some of these groups can act as basic bronchocellular centers, like the chromines and the pyrimines. And we also have the localized P electrons that will act as basic Lewis centers that will be the electron donors for our process. So regarding the catalytic water oxidation, we have an efficient process which is already in use at the industrial scale, and it's autogenic for streams with a very high organic load. So starting from COD of 10 grams per liter, the exothermic reaction will keep the temperature constant in our process. Nonetheless, we also have a series of limitations. We have a very limited oxygen solubility. This is a slow reaction because of the polymer deposition, and it requires high temperature and pressure. And it's only feasible when we have very high organic loads, so we can only apply it for industrial water streams. So what happens when we have lower concentrations? We are all working here in contaminants of emerging concern. We are working now in nanograms, micrograms per liter. We cannot apply this. So we can go to the CWPO process. Here we are going to have the activation of hydrogen peroxide with a catalyst to generate hydroxyl radicals. We've talked about this in previous lessons, so I'm going to go a little bit quicker. So here the catalyst will give an electron, and the special thing about the catalytic wet peroxide oxidation is that the hydrogen peroxide can be oxidized or reduced, so it can also regenerate the catalyst, giving rise to the hydroperoxyl radical, which, if you recall, is the same one that we use in the catalytic water oxidation process. This is not the only reaction that we have. Also, the organic intermediates can regenerate the catalyst. And most importantly, we have a series of parasitic reactions that we want to avoid. Especially the first one, we want to avoid the recombination of hydroxyl and hydroperoxyl radicals, giving rise to water and oxygen. So, the homogeneous process, the Fenton, we've already talked about it. This is feasible due to the reduction and oxidation potentials of the hydrogen peroxide. If you see, the reduction potential of iron is of 0.77 volts, and for both processes, it's spontaneous. This happens not only with iron. We have other metal cells that we have a redox pair, which is able to take out to carry out the hydrogen peroxide decomposition, but these are more toxic and more expensive. So Fenton is the iron is the most used one when we are talking about Fenton. The homogeneous Fenton process has a series of advantages. It's ease of operation. We only need iron and hydrogen peroxide in a very simple vessel to carry it out. And the high ability and low cost of the reagents is going to make our process viable. But unless we are working with complexation agents, as we saw yesterday, we are going to be obliged to work at low pH, and we will have the catalyst lost and a residue to manage due to the formation of iron sludges. So, due to this disadvantage, most authors were working on the development of a heterogeneous process on catalytic wet peroxide oxidation. And in the catalyst design, we have to consider the activity of the materials, the stability, and also the recoverability of these materials. So first of all, I want to introduce the traditional catalyst, which would be a metal immobilized into a support, which can be activated carbon, alumina, zeolites, as many as you can imagine. These materials have a very high activity, but the stability, as we told us before, is very limited due to the metal leaching, and this makes our catalyst very expensive. In order to overcome this drawback, we have the non-conventional catalyst, and in terms of recoverability, we have the magnetic catalysts. In the non-conventional catalyst, we can talk about two different sections: iron-bearing minerals or residues, such as this shown in your slide, goethite, hematite, magnetite, and iron tailings, and also carbon materials, from amorphous ones to more ordered, as Rhee has told us before. Sorry for repeating the same. So these non-conventional catalysts have a very high stability, but the activity is significantly lower in relation to the traditional ones. So in order to make this process feasible, we have to change the operating conditions and go to the process intensification. Now I would like to present you some examples of a research group in which we've used minerals and carbon materials intensified with high temperature processes ultraviolet and visible radiation, and also with microwave radiation. So in the case of natural iron minerals, Macarena Muñoz, she combined it with high temperature heterogeneous phantom process using magnetite and ilmenite, which are magnetic and easily recoverable, and also hematite. She tested it with the model pollutant phenol working at 75 degrees Celsius. As you may see, in all the cases, she achieved a complete phenol oxidation with an around 75% mineralization degree, which is a very good result, and an almost complete hydrogen peroxide decomposition. She also studied the stability of these materials, and you can see that magnetite and hematite maintained their activity, although magnetite had a very high iron leaching in the first circles of reaction. Then, after the second use, we can reuse it without exceeding the iron levels in the effluent. In the case of ilmenite, we cannot reuse this catalyst because it completely lost its activity after one use due to the deposition of phenol polymers on the surface. So what can we do with ilmenite? Well, this is a combination of iron and titanium on its structure, and it's a natural photocatalyst with an energy with a band gap of 2.4 electron volts. Nonetheless, it's a very bad photocatalyst. I don't know if you see well in this slide. The first points would be the activity of the ilmenite, and the black points would be the activity of the GUSAP-P95. So as a photocatalyst by itself, it's not very good. But we can combine the iron and the titanium in the CWPO and the solar-assisted CWPO of also phenol as model pollutant. Here you can see that introducing the solar radiation, we could achieve an almost complete mineralization with a 95% TOC removal and a complete phenol elimination in only 4 hours. This is due to the configuration of the ilmenite, so we are going to have, on one hand, the redox cycle of the hydrogen peroxide due to the iron species, and also the titanium dioxide in the interior of the structure is going to have a photocatalytic activity in this process. Also, iron acts as a natural doping agent, for us to say also, and we have a lower electron hole pair recombination. So, in the case of ilmenite, we have that the ultraviolet radiation increases the activity and that we have a very high hydrogen peroxide exploitation, which is one of the critical issues in the phenton and CWPO processes. Also, on carbon materials working at high temperature, just in the same way that they act with the catalytic water oxidation, the carbon materials can act as catalysts for the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide due to the high mobility of the electrons that they present. So here, Carmen Dominguez, she tested them for real winery wastewater with a very high organic load. And she tested the non-catalytic process and three different carbon materials, activated carbon, graphite, and carbon black. Here you can see that the graphite, the most ordered material, presented the highest activity with around a 60% reduction of the total organic carbon, the COD, sorry, working at 80 degrees Celsius. But if we take the activated carbon and we increase the temperature, we can increase the efficiency of the process. As you can see, at 80 degrees, we only have around a 30% of the hydrogen peroxide decomposition. And when we increase this value up to 125 degrees C, we have a 95% hydrogen peroxide decomposition and around a 60% TOC removal. Now I'm getting to my favorite part of this talk, which is the topic of my thesis. So after the work that Carmen Dominguez developed, we knew that the carbon materials were active at a very high temperature. And we were looking for different ways of heating our process, and also more efficient, because as you know, the microwave radiation can achieve a very rapid and homogeneous heating. So in the first work, we compared two different catalysts that we use in our laboratory, which are iron overactivated carbon and iron over alumina, also for the oxidation of phenol using the stoichiometric dose of hydrogen peroxide and working at 120 degrees C. So here you see the process without microwaves. We have the same active phase, the same iron load, which is at 4%, And so we have the same behavior in the materials for hydrogen peroxide decomposition and also for TOC removal. Nonetheless, when we introduce microwave radiation in the system, we observe that for the activated carbon, we had a major increase in the hydrogen peroxide decomposition, which was also translated in a higher TOC removal. But in the case of alumina, we were carrying out the decomposition of a higher amount of hydrogen peroxide due to the hemolytic rupture caused by the microwave, but we have the similar TOC removal. And so we ask ourselves, what is going on here? Well, the most interesting feature about microwaves is that they can interact with different materials in different ways. So we have opaque, transparent, and absorbent materials. The microwave absorbers can accumulate the microwave energy and dissipate it in the form of hotspots due to the uneven heating. These hotspots are microplasma regions that can rise its temperature locally up to 1,200 degrees C, and they are going to help us to degrade the contaminants. So we corroborated these results working without catalyst in the Blank experiment to see the contribution of microwaves by themselves with the bare alumina and with the bare activated carbon. And as you can see, the alumina by itself had not any activity at all, and the activated carbon by itself was a very good catalyst. We had a complete oxidation, a complete elimination of the hydrogen peroxide in the system, and a TOC removal around 85%. So after this, we decided to test different carbon materials, everything that we could find in our laboratory, we put it in the microwave. And so we tested activated carbon, graphite, carbon black, and silicon carbide for the same reaction. And here you can see the results. If you remember, I told you before that we want to avoid the auto-scavenging reactions. And if you pay attention to the pink triangles, the light pink one, which is the activated carbon chembiron, has a complete hydrogen peroxide decomposition in only 5 minutes reaction and a lower TOC removal than the activated carbon Merck. So if we are doing a very quick hydrogen peroxide decomposition, we are not taking the best advantage of these radicals. They are going to recombine, and this is nonsense. When we used activated carbon Merck, we had a progressive consumption of the hydrogen peroxide and a better reagent usage with a 94% TOC removal. So as you can see in this image, the best catalysts were activated carbon Merck and graphite sigma. And we subjected this to a stability test during 5 cycles. Here you see that the stability is also a very important issue. In the case of graphite sigma, we have an activity loss of around 5%, so these are very active materials, whereas the activated carbon had a very quick and progressive deactivation. We've related this to the structure of the material and the heat dissipation generated by the hotspots. In the case of graphite, which is a laminar structure, the hotspots, when they are formed between the layers, the heat can be dissipated and the structure of the catalyst is maintained. In the case of activated carbon, if we form these hotspots inside the micropores, we are going to have a vapor, overheated vapor, in a very confined region, and so we are going to have microexplosions in the same way that we have when we make popcorn in our microwave. So we've called this the popcorn effect. We could observe this because between the successive cycles, it was more and more and more difficult to retrieve the catalyst. It was like a very, very dusty powder, and we cannot retrieve all the activated carbon from the effluent. So now, going on to the magnetic catalysts, we can tune the magnetic properties of our iron phase with the calcination and a successive reduction of our iron species in order to obtain a magnetic support, a magnetic catalyst that we can easily retrieve from the aqueous phase after the reaction. So is this the only special feature about the magnetic catalyst? Well, it's not. Here another work from Macarena Muñoz. She worked with iron alumina catalysts, magnetic and non-magnetic. And here you can see that with both catalysts, she could achieve a complete oxidation of phenol with a very high, here's not, but she also obtained a very high CO2 removal. And in the case of the magnetic one, the kinetic rate was enhanced, not only for the hydrogen peroxide decomposition, also for the chlorofino removal. So we have an efficient hydrogen peroxide usage despite having a high reaction rate. We can also use natural magnetite, as I told you previously, and the last works that Macarena has done are working on relevant matrices for the removal of contaminants of emerging concern. So here you see that she has tested over hospital wastewater, wastewater treatment plant effluent, surface water, and deionized water. Obviously, when the complexity of the matrix increases, the elimination of the contaminant is reduced. But we have that we have a catalyst that is active in a wider operational range that, for example, the iron here, she's working at pH 5. It's an expensive catalyst. It's easily recoverable, and she had a very low iron reaching in these conditions. So as a way to conclude this speech, I'd like you to remind you that the catalytic water oxidation is used to generate the higher oxygen reaction to superoxide radical, which becomes hydroperoxyl radical. And we have the catalyst regeneration by the reaction byproducts. Whereas in the CWPO, we have the hydrogen peroxide reduction giving rise to hydroxyl radicals. And the catalyst regeneration can be also done by the same hydrogen peroxide giving rise to hydroperoxyl radicals and also by the reaction byproducts. The catalytic water oxidation is already in use at the industrial scale. But in the case of CWPO, only the homogeneous process, the Fenton, has reached this level of development. In the catalytic water oxidation, we have a slow reaction, which requires high temperature and pressure, whereas in CWPO, we have a quick reaction that allows us to work at mild temperature and pressure. CWAO is only feasible for higher organic loads, whereas CWPO has a wider operational range. But the CWAO is an autogenic process. We can auto-suppress temperature in the process. And in CWPO, the most recent feature is that the process intensification allows us to use low-cost catalysts. So I hope I haven't repeated a lot of concepts and been very repetitive in this talk, and I would like to thank you for your attention.